The wonders of an age gone by are known to us today. One tells us of a city on the Elbe banks it lay. We remember now Dresden, the beautiful town, the charm and the splendor, a place of renown. The folk in the city could hear all along the banks of the Elbe a firm, joyful song. Neither Hamburg nor Dresden from fair Elbe land was spared the harsh fate at the murderer's hand. O'er Germany the sun went down and flames engulfed the night. The fires raged and you'll hear Dresdners scream out in their plight. The German jewels lost, the flames have left their brand. Old Dresden, you are lost now to the German fatherland. In the year 1206, the name of Dresden is mentioned for the first time. Two parts separated by the river Elbe are joined by a stone bridge, and thus Dresden was born. The middle of the 16th century saw the rise of the Elbe metropolis into the most important Protestant territorial state of Germany. Dresden was raised to a royal seat by the Bithynians, and on the accession to the throne of Friedrich Augustus I, later called Augustus the Strong, Dresden became a brilliant center of artistic creation and creative spirit. A jewel on the banks of the Elbe, admired by the whole world. This special atmosphere in Dresden came about at that time and was to last almost 300 years. Please climb aboard and come with us on a visit to Dresden. Here, the Altstädter Werk, which was built by Gottfried Schinkel in classical style. The Semper Oper at the Theaterplatz near to the Elbe bank was built by Manfred von Semper according to the plans drawn by his father, Gottfried von Semper. There are many famous names connected with Dresden's opera house. Two of Richard Wagner's works, The Flying Dutchman and Tannhauser, had their first performances here, as well as the great works of Richard Strauss. But it was Karl Maria von Weber who began a new era of German opera here. The Zwinger. This marvel of Saxon sandstone was created by the highly imaginative Baroque architect Daniel Purpleman at the command of his prince, who loved art. This monumental court was once home to magnificent events and masquerades, for Augustus the Strong loved a display of splendor. The lavish figures and sculptures were created by the sculptor Balthasar Pelmoser. With abundant riches, he brightened up this cheerful architecture. The special charm of the Zwinge consisted in the harmonic interaction of architecture and water, reaching its climax here in the Nymphenbad. Created in a golden age of art, the Zwinge remained for centuries a festival site of the most magnificent dimensions. In the course of time, the Zwinge pavilions were filled with valuable collections. For example, the oldest mineralogy museum in the world, the famous collection of porcelain, and the drawing room of mathematics and physics. With almost 2,000 marvels of precision engineering in the field of time measurement, it is one of the oldest technical collections. The courtyard of the Zwinge incorporated a famous and much admired collection, the Dresdner Gemälde Galerie. Its greatest treasure was Raphael's Sistine Madonna. In a special room, it radiated its entire beauty and divine majesty over the visitors. The artistic wealth of Europe was housed in the picture gallery at Dresden. Rubens, Miliarca, and Atlante. And Satyr and Tigris. Rembrandt's self-portrait with Saskia. Wedding at Cana by Veronese. The Madonna by Urilium. Carencio's The Penitential Magdalena. The Sleeping Venus by Giorgione. Titian's The Tribute Money. The Matchmaker by Vermeer of Delft. Lee Otter, The Chocolate Girl. The Wedding Procession by Ludwig Richter. The Crossing Over at the Stone of Horror. From Caspar David Friedrich, The Cross in the Elbe Mountains. Hotel Bellevue, the little Italian village, the Catholic court church and the castle. The enormous castle tower rose above all the other towers of the town. The large castle courtyard with its richly decorated staircase tower was an important work of German Renaissance artists. Inside the castles were magnificent banqueting rooms, the ballroom with thousands of candles, and the large hall for festive court receptions, with its valuable wall hangings made in the Saxon weaving mills. The castle's tower room housed a precious collection of rare porcelain from Japan, China, and Old Meissen. This name was known by the whole world. It was aptly christened after the green color of the room which contained the silver treasure of the Bithynians. The green vault was the largest European treasure chamber and shone with fairy tale brilliance. Its material value was estimated at over 40 million marks, but its real value was incalculable. The treasures stored here dazzled not only because of their value or their size. They captivated, above all, because of their outstanding aesthetic quality. At the command of Augustus the Strong, artists of the highest order created incomparable treasures. The three Dinglinger brothers worked together with 14 assistants for 8 years on this court of the mogul. Today, these fantastic treasures have been scattered to the four corners of the earth. Dresden's greatest personality, the golden figure of the Rathaus man, rises up to a height of 6 meters. He serves to measure the size of the monumental city hall, which was built by Karl Rote in modern Baroque style on the former castle walls. Prager-Strasse enticed one to stroll around and shop. It was the most elegant shopping street in Dresden. Dresden had a reputation as a garden town. Its most beautiful park with wonderful trees was the Grosser Garten. Johann Georg III had this Italian garden palazzo built. Corradini's Flora Vase. Time steals beauty. The Hygiene Museum owes its creation to Carl August Lehner. His famous international hygiene exhibition of 1911 drew every eye to Dresden. Carl August Lehner placed man as the central point. With this live visual instruction, a successful method of educating the people in social hygiene was established, and this set an example for the whole world. The center point of the German Hygiene Museum was provided by the Glass Man. Catholic Court Church. This glorious place of worship was built by Corelli in the middle of the 18th century. 78 holy statues decorate its sweeping, fluid balustrades. From the court chapel, the view opens out onto the new town. The only high-rise building in Dresden was on the Albertplatz. This axis formed the meeting place between old and new Dresden. The blockhouse by the master builder Longlu. With the construction of the new town came the four-storied houses for the bourgeoisie. At the end of this lane stood the birthplace of Theodor Körner. It became a commemorative site for the poet and freedom fighter. The Körner family house provided a center of spiritual life. Here many guests met, including, among the most famous, Mozart, Goethe and Schiller. To house his Japanese porcelain, Augustus the Strong built the so-called Japanese Palace. Upstream along the river Elbe on the Lerschwitzer Hängen, the castles of Albrecht are sited. The first suspension bridge in Europe spanned the Elbe between Blaeswitz and Lerschwitz. The people called it the Blue Miracle because of its color. On the other side of the Elbe lies Blaeswitz, immortalized by Schiller in his Gustl. The Luisenhof on the Heights, near the well-known White Deer Roam and the famous sanatorium which welcomed guests from all over the world. Ostplatz, the heart of the town traffic. The circus is coming. Saracini settle in Dresden. Out of the tent and under a permanent roof. In the first half of the century, culture and tradition occupy a high position in the social life of Dresden. Celebrating festivals, another Dresden tradition. Emperor Wilhelm II in Dresden in 1914 before the outbreak of war. In 1928, the Imperial President von Hindenburg visits the capital of Saxony. In 1933, a great day for the Saxon SR. The salute is taken by Ernst Röhm. consecration of the flag by the highest leader of the SA. Over the Augustus Bridge and passing by the Brucian terraces. The Old Market, center of the inner city. Dresden's landmark, the Frauenkirche. Dresden at night. Under the old festive lights. Once again, we return to the Zwinger. An evening serenade awaits us. And unforgettable too, Dresden in winter with its Christmas magic emanating from the 400-year-old Streiselmarkt, with the delightful toys from the Erzgebirge. The comical Pflaumentoffeln, the gingerbread from Pulsnitz, and the high-pitched voices of the children from the Dresdner Kreuzchor. It is the night of February the 13th, 1945, when the first of two waves of British Lancaster bombers assemble over England and approach Dresden. The German regional headquarters had already spotted the heavy bomber unit approaching Saxony. At around 9:40 p.m., the announcement is made. Attention, attention, heavy enemy units over Middle Germany, flying in the direction of Leipzig or Dresden. Full alert without any early warning. At first, the radio is silent, but then comes a man's voice shouting in great agitation. The bombers are turning. They're turning towards Dresden. They're coming. At around 10:15 p.m., 244 bombers of the first wave reach the capital of Saxony.
Eine Frau schrie gleich im Keller, die fuhr nur so vor den Nerven. Und ich saß da, hielt mir die Aktentasche über den Kopf und hab geglaubt, das könnte mich schützen. Und jeder reagierte immer und alle in panischer Angst. Und dann fielen schon rings um die Bomben in der Nachbarschaft. Wir merkten, dass das große Sprengbomben waren. Dann die Detonation, der Luftdruck, da flogen die Kellerfenster durch den Luftdruck, die flogen durch den Keller. Die Türen, die warf es durch den Keller und da war man schon froh, wenn man nicht abbekam. Und das war eine Hölle.
Und da kam der Phosphor, da kam er durch den Keller, durch so ein Loch nachher reingelaufen. Und da mussten wir natürlich sehen, dass wir rauskamen aus dem Haus. Da sind wir da durch die Durchbrüche.
Und wie der Angriff war? Da kriegten wir rauf ins Parkhotel alle verbrannten, jung oder alt, ohne Nasen, ohne Ohren und sonst was. Der Dr. Ernst und der Dr. Wappner, zwei Ärzte waren nur da. Die haben also Tag und Nacht dort unten auf Tischen, auf einfachen Tischen gearbeitet, um den Menschen zu helfen.
Dresden war zu der Zeit sehr überfüllt, weil der Osten geräumt werden musste, Schlesien und so weiter, sodass unheimlich viele Menschen noch am Hauptbahnhof, im Großen Garten, an der Elbe, gelagert waren, untergebracht waren und dadurch noch mehr Menschen umgekommen sind, als normalerweise sonst in Dresden umgekommen wären.
Zum großen Teil, die ganze Innenstadt, das war ja total kaputt und wo kein direkter Volltreffer rein war, die sind dann durch die ganze Hitze umgekommen. Also es sind kaum Flüchtlinge lebendig aus Dresden rausgekommen.
Each of the 245 aeroplanes dropped 5 or 6 tons of high-explosive bombs and firebombs. In the course of the night, we dropped approximately 750,000 firebombs. Firebombs and phosphor bombs. Phosphor bombs were not allowed under the Geneva Convention, but we used them all the same.
Da sind die Menschen im Asphalt, im heißen Asphalt, mit ihren Schuhen stecken geblieben. Also da wird viel erzählt, dass da die Menschen direkt gebrannt haben und der Asphalt so heiß war, dass die sich gar nicht retten können.
Then the sparks rained down. The sparks flew in through the broken windows and set fire to the curtains. It was the most diabolical plan ever conceived. It did not happen by accident. We did it on purpose.
Und da hörte ich in der Ferne eine Frau schreien, die schrie, Hilfe, helft mir doch, nehmt mich mit. Ja, ich wusste nicht, das war weit weg, man wusste ja gar nicht, wo die arme Frau lag. Und da kam ich ins Krankenhausgelände, Johannstädter Krankenhaus. Irgendwelche Menschen rannten mit und plötzlich reißt mich jemand hinten am Kragen zurück Und in dem Moment klatschte von dem brennenden Krankenhaus so ein Stück Fenstersims, wo meine Füße direkt vor die Füße. Wenn ich das abgekriegt hätte, wäre ich erledigt gewesen. Ne? Und ich habe dort ganz vergessen, Danke zu sagen. Dann bin ich weitergerannt und mit irgendjemandem, wer das war, an der Elbe runter. Wir wollten ins Freie, wir konnten keine Mauer mehr aushalten.
As the Eastern Front moved ever closer to the Reich at the end of 1944, the anti-aircraft guns defending the city were dismantled and sent to the Oder Front. They were to be used there in the fight against the attacking Soviet tanks.
Entlang der Oder haben sich Grenadiere und MG-Trupps eingenistet. Auch am Bahndamm und in der weiteren Umgebung des Odergeländes sind die Stellungen der Infanterie und unserer Batterie. Sowjetische Panzer haben die angreifenden deutschen Sturmgeschütze erkannt. Sie versuchen, sich in wilder Querfeldeinfahrt in Sicherheit zu bringen. Doch die deutschen Granaten sind schneller. Noch vor Erreichen der Straße werden die Sowjetpanzer vom Feuer erfasst.
The front was only 130 kilometers away from Dresden. The capital of Saxony was therefore almost completely defenseless. In peacetime, the city had 630,000 inhabitants. Now, because of the refugees that the town had to accommodate, there were between 1.2 and 1.4 million people there.
Der Ansturm der Bolschewisten zwang Hunderttausende deutscher Menschen, alles, was sie an Gut und Boden besaßen, aufzugeben und nur sich selbst und das zum Leben Notwendigste in Sicherheit zu bringen. In Trecks, die von Morgen bis Abend reichen, ziehen Tausende von Gespannen und Fahrzeugen über das Eis in den Schutz des Reiches.
As the city had been mainly spared in the air raids during the war, there were many rumors circulating in Dresden about why the town would not be bombed by the Allies. The most erroneous stories turned up. But most of all, the people of Dresden put their trust in the goodwill of the British and Americans. The town, which had to accommodate a daily increasing number of hospitals and sick bays, could never be the target of an air raid. Of that, the people in Dresden at that time were convinced. The Soviets had twice been informed by the Americans of the approaching attack. They registered no protest. The initial attack with only 244 bombers was to be followed by a night attack with 529 Lancaster bombers. In the double attack on Dresden, the firestorm was an integral part of the plan. For the first time in history, a firestorm was consciously planned. This second unit, almost double the size of the first, was also spotted by the German regional headquarters. But the German night fighters had been banned from takeoff because of fuel shortages.
Startquadrat 503, Flugzeug Richtung Südost, ein Viertel Ost, 0,25.
Befehl an Major Lent.
Es geht los, erstmal die Sitzbereitschaft.
But no order for takeoff followed the standby order. The commanding officer of the military airfield was unable to reach the headquarters in Berlin to get permission to attack. The telephone lines had already been cut off by the first attack on Dresden. So the 18 ME-110 night fighters on the aerodrome at Klotsch, only 8 kilometres away from the city, had to stand by and watch in bitter silence the destruction of Dresden.
In Krankenhäusern werden die Patienten in bombensichere Bunker gebracht.
Dann sind wir raus auf die Straße, in die Nebenstraße, und dort habe ich was erlebt, was ich mir noch nie vorstellen konnte, was ich nur im Märchenbuch gelesen habe. Da rollten Feuerräder durch die Straße, die waren dunkel, und das war ein Feuersturm. Große dunkle Räder, die rasten dort durch die Straße, es war unheimlich alles.
Da kam so wuchtig, nur dass dann eben alles weg war. Die Menschen, die sind ja gerannt wie die Wahnsinnigen. Ringsrum brannte es. Es brannte nur alles, alles.
Und da möchte ich ihn zu den Bomben was sagen. Das waren sogenannte Phosphorbomben. Und die fielen, wenn die in den Hof runterfielen, plumpsten auf und dann drehte sich das Rad. Da war doch rundherum bis in den Keller rein überall Phosphor.
Es brannten die Häuser überall. Es saßen 2 Straßenbahner am Fetscherplatz, von denen wir annahmen, die lebten. Erst hinterher merken wir, die waren schon tot. Und dann brennende Häuser über brennende Häuser, Leichenhaufen über Leichenhaufen, die Leichen zusammengeschrumpft, winzig klein.
Do you know why we waited for 2 hours in between the 2 air raids on Dresden? That interval of 2 hours in between the 2 air raids on Dresden was there for 2 reasons. Firstly, so that the extensive fires could spread to epic proportions. Secondly, so that all the fire brigade and ambulance units from the surrounding areas could reach Dresden, and then, when they were in the middle of their work, we could return with an even bigger blow. That is not fiction. That is the way it is written down in the operational orders. We did it on purpose, in order to drag the fire brigades, the hospitals, indeed, all the supply units into the tragedy. There are evil people sitting behind the desks in uniform, be they colonels, majors or whatever. There they sat, brooding and thinking about how they could kill the most civilians.
Und hab dann mein Kind gesucht. Und da habe ich dann doch mal eins getroffen von der Familie. Die wussten ja auch nicht, wo die Kinder waren. Da sind die doch in dem Keller gewesen, noch bis donnerstags. Und da sind die dann über die Elbe.
Es waren auch Kinder mit im Luftschutzkeller. Wir haben uns dann auf den Fußboden langgelegt, haben die Kinder unter uns genommen, um die Kinder zu schützen vor herabfallenden Teilen, die von der Decke herunterkamen, Putz und Mörtel.
On January the 25th, 1945, late in the day before he left for his club and his evening with friends, Winston Churchill telephones the Minister of Aviation to ask him what proposals Bomber Command could come up with to roast the Germans trying to escape from Breslau. To roast the Germans, to base the Germans. What do you suggest? What was that about Breslau? Breslau was a German city that had been surrounded by the Russians a few days earlier, and streams of refugees were leaving Breslau and hurrying across the country in the direction of Dresden.
Die Stadt brannte, das war ein Feuerschein und Dunkelheit und Feuerschein zugleich. Das ist überhaupt nicht zu beschreiben, ne? Ganz grausam.
The aim was to kill the German civilians. And when Air Marshal Harris, whom I met personally, the supreme commander of the British Bomber Command, took up his post in February 1942, the order was already in hand. I hope so, so said Winston Churchill. I hope that the new supreme commander of Bomber Command is aware that our targets in future will not be only the factories in the respective towns, but the surrounding civilian areas, the workers' houses, the centers of population. There it is, written down in black and white in the English archives. We're not just attacking military targets anymore, we're attacking the people, because this also has an effect on morale. It has an effect on mood. It's a crime. Today, this is generally acknowledged as a war crime. According to the Geneva Convention, it is a crime to attack the civilian population. Winston Churchill signed that order and intended it to be done like that.
Ja, es war bloß die Zivilbevölkerung, die es betroffen hat, alles. Denn Fabriken war ja weiter nichts da. Es war ja direkt die Innenstadt, alles, was sie da kaputt gemacht haben. Es wäre ja gar nicht notwendig gewesen.
Eine Frau mit ihrer Tochter, die ist mit verbrannt. Meine Schwester, die hat im Nebenhaus gewohnt. Dort haben aber vielleicht 20 Kinder mit drinnen gewohnt in dem Haus. Die sind alle verbrannt. Am lebenden Leib verbrannt.
Die eine hatte einen Kinderwagen, die sagt, ich habe auf der Fletcherstraße, das war damals die Fürstenstraße, dort in der Dreher habe ich ja gewohnt. Die hatte dort aus einer brennenden Wohnung, da war keine Mutter da, die Türe war offen. Da hat die einen Kinderwagen rausgezogen mit dem Kind. Das hatte die mitgenommen, keine Mutter da, ne? Und alles brannte. Dann war ein junges Ehepaar, oder gehörten sie als Freunde zusammen, französische Fremdarbeiter, ganz junge Leute. Die hatten ein Kindchen, so ein Kerlchen hier, blonde Locken, also sie hätten es können aus dem Jesusbild nehmen. Blonde Locken, und das hielt sie so und war ein goldisches Kerlchen, das lachte, strahlte. Ne? Und das hatten die auch irgendwo, ich weiß nicht, ob die es gefunden hatten, ich konnte sie nicht verstehen, irgendwo mitgenommen und na, hatten das auf dem Arm und das Kind lachte. Das war das Leben.
War und ich auf die Straße ging, dem Feuersturm entgegen, da sah ich tote Menschen, nackt. Ich dachte, warum sind die nackt? Die haben an den Kleidern gebrannt und haben sich die Kleider vom Leibe gerissen. Ich habe nie so viele Tote gesehen wie nach diesem Angriff.
es war furchtbar, es war furchtbar. Meine Tochter am Sachsenplatz, da sind wir die Stufen hoch und da lagen die Leichen, nur die Körper. Und da fragte mich meine Tochter, Mami, was ist denn das, was hier liegt? Ich sage, komm, guck dir es nicht an, das sind alles Leichen.
Man war vollkommen sinnlos und schwer zu beschreiben. Und jedenfalls kommt mir dort im Dunkeln ein Mann entgegen, sehe ich plötzlich eine Gestalt auf mich zukommen von kleinen Scharwitzer Ufer her. Und da bleibt er stehen, hat einen Handkoffer in der Hand und lacht ganz laut und ganz irre. Es war unheimlich. Ich habe gedacht, der Teufel steht auf der Erde. Und da sagt er plötzlich, wir Polen und Tschechen, wir haben gewusst, wir haben gewusst. Und morgen kommt noch ein Angriff. Ja. Also ich war so entsetzt, erst der Anblick von der Stadt und dann dieser Mensch. Ich stand da, ich war von Entsetzen geschüttelt.
Aber die haben alle uns alles weggenommen. Ich weiß, wir hatten einen sehr netten Querschnittsgelähmten, der hatte einen weiten Weg noch, wo der hin wollte. Und den haben sie auch die Hosen und alles ausgezogen. Also die Tschechen waren unmöglich, das kann ich nie vergessen.
Ich habe die Pflege dann gefragt, was wurde ihnen gesagt? Und die haben mir erzählt, als würde er ihnen erzählt von Flüchtlingen. Es wurde aber auch gesagt, dass Dresden ein Arsenal, ein Waffenfabrikstadt sei.
I then asked the pilots what they had been told. They answered that they had been told about the refugees. But on the other hand, they had also been told that Dresden was an arsenal, a city of munition factories. They were told about railways, armament factories, and party headquarters, which had been moved to Dresden. Utter nonsense. In the meanwhile, we have found a telex in the English archives, which will interest you a great deal. It is the telex which was sent that night to all military airfields for the instruction of the crews. The aim of the attack is to hit the enemy where it will hurt most. And later in the flight instruction comes the statement, and besides, the intention is to warn the Russians so that they will recognize them when they come and see what our bomber unit is able to do. Doesn't this show the air raid on Dresden in a new light? They wanted to warn the Russians so that they would recognize them when they came and saw what our bomber unit was able to do. The relations between the Western Allies and the Soviets had worsened towards the end of the year 1944. Strong voices, like that of General Patton, warned of the Soviets and advocated peace with Germany. Even the Germanophobe Churchill seemed to have some doubts about the loyalty of the Soviets, for he declared in the ruined city of Aachen in January 1945, "Looks like we've slaughtered the wrong pig." This outrageous remark of such incomparable bad taste bears witness to the megalomania of the British Prime Minister and his contempt for mankind. With the message from the Defense Department, Dresden is at the moment overcrowded with hundreds and thousands of refugees from the east, Churchill was given precise information about the real situation in the city, but he personally ordered the mass murder of Dresden. The Chief of Bomber Command, Air Marshal Harris, carried out the criminal order.
Nach dem Angriff dann bin ich weiter, da war ich plötzlich alleine, alles verstreute sich und da bin ich auf der Elbwiese, dann habe ich mich umgesehen. Das erste Mal umgesehen und dort habe ich geweint um Dresden, geheult um meine Stadt.
morning of February the 14th, as the first sunbeams make their weary way through the swirling smoke of the still-burning city, you can pick out the people, tens of thousands of them, trying to escape from Dresden via the city's arterial roads.
Auf der Müglitztalstraße in Donau. Dann bin ich auf Menschen gestoßen. Dort war der Elendszug von Dresden bis rauf ins Erzgebirge. Die ganzen Ausgebombten, Kranke, Invaliden, Kinder, schwarz wie die Nacht alle, schleppte sich. Also dieser Elendszug, das vergisst man nie. Das kann man nicht. Furchtbar, wie die sich schleppen. Manche hatten eine Kinderwägelchen, manche hatten einen Leiterwagen. Das ganze Mühlsal, das müssen Sie sich mal vorstellen, wie lang das ist, von Dresden bis ins Erzgebirge, wie lang das ist. February the 14th, 1945, 450 flying fortresses of the American Air Force take off for the third air raid on Dresden. The threefold blow on the dying Saxon capital is to complete the work. Not only the bombers which make this third attack so horrible, but most of all it's the escort fighters, the Mustangs. Along the meadows on the banks of the Elbe, they pursue a murderous manhunt on women, children and old people.
Und da kam wieder Flieger, einer, ne? Ganz, ganz tief. Die haben tatsächlich auf die einzelnen Menschen gezielt.
Und dann kamen in den nächsten Tagen immer wieder Tiefflieger. Es war also auch da sehr gefährlich, sich auf die Straßen zu begeben.
Und da kommen da immer wieder noch die Tiefflieger, wie hießen denn die anderen Flieger. Wenn da die Leute den Kopf raussteckten, da war der Kopf weg.
Einige im großen Garten, einige sind nach der Elbe gelaufen und haben sich hingeworfen. Und da sind diese Menschen gekommen, sind das nur Menschen gewesen, geflogen gekommen und haben mit Bordwaffen auf die hilflosen Menschen, die da gelegen haben, geschossen und haben, also jetzt. und haben so viele noch getroffen, verwundet. Wir hatten ja nichts mehr. Also das ist mit das Grässlichste überhaupt. Wobei noch zu sagen ist, dass die Firmen hier in Heidenau nicht eine Bombe abgekommen haben. Das war ein ausländisches Kapital dabei. Die kriegten nicht eine einzige Bombe ab. Aber die Margarinefabriken, die wurden bombardiert, ist auch gegen die Menschen, auch gegen uns gerichtet gewesen.
Es war kaum zu beschreiben. Ich kann das bloß bestätigen, dass die Flieger so tief kamen, als hier die Heimbewohnerin sagte, so tief kamen, dass sie Freude dran hatten, wenn sie einen Menschen erwischen. Und das war auch nachher noch so.
Das waren Kinder, Geisel, wer war denn noch da? Frauen.
Who actually started this aerial warfare against the capitals? Well, I've been working on a biography of Winston Churchill for 15 years, and here I have to say that it has been proven beyond doubt. Winston Churchill unleashed the aerial warfare on the German cities in the summer of 1940, and for three reasons. First, in the summer of 1940, Churchill had just become Prime Minister of England, and at that time the desire for peace was becoming vocal. There were even secret rallies in the street in front of his apartment, peace rallies. People could no longer see any sense in the war. Poland no longer existed. France had been conquered. The Germans had already begun to offer peace conditions, which were quite acceptable. But these offers of peace were never published. Winston Churchill knew about it from decoding the radio. The German ambassador in Washington was contacted by the English ambassador in Washington, a memorable day. On July the 20th, 1940, the British ambassador, Lord Luthien, asked of his own bat, what are the German conditions? What is the German offer for peace? The German ambassador, Ernst Thompson, sent a radio message to Berlin, coded by the Enigma machine. The English ambassador wants to know what our offer is for peace. Churchill had it decoded and read it. On the very same day, July 20th, 1940, he summoned Air Marshal Sir Charles Porter, commander of the British Bomber Command, and asked him, Sir Charles, what is the earliest moment at which we can attack Berlin to great effect? Until that time, no bomb had fallen on London and none on Berlin. That is to say, neither had attacked the other's capital city. But now Churchill wanted to know how soon Berlin could be attacked. The answer from Sir Charles, Prime Minister, it is still summer, July 20th. The nights are too short. We cannot even reach Berlin. The earliest time we could do it would be September 1st. Besides, we would also have the first 100 Sterling bombers then. The big four-engine bomber aircraft were due to be delivered by that date. Churchill says, good, prepare everything for a full-scale attack on Berlin. And Air Chief Marshal Sir Charles Porter points out, but Prime Minister, if we attack Berlin now, and we know from the radio decoding that Hitler had given the order not to attack London, and that he has not ordered a general area warfare on English cities, I point out, if we attack Berlin now, Hitler will raise his embargo and will unleash an attack on London. Churchill blinked his eyes. It suited him perfectly that Hitler would now bomb London. It was not yet possible, the nights were too short. August the 24th, it is still the year 1940, but that was fateful for the German cities. August the 24th, and a bomb falls on London in the working class area. Nobody was killed, just a few chickens were killed. A German aeroplane had lost its bearings. The crew was later court-martialed by the German Air Force. I know those names. But that was reason enough for Winston Churchill to ask at 9:10 on the next morning, August the 25th, for a direct line from his country seat Chequers to the headquarters of British Bomber Command. "I demand that Berlin be attacked tonight with at least 100 planes." Again, the British Bomber Command refuses. We know that because in the English archives, the actual words of this phone call are recorded. Bomber Command wanted it known precisely who was responsible for this historic turn of events. 9:10 on the morning of August the 25th, 1940, Bomber Command refuses. Churchill insists. Bomber Command says, "Actually, we are planning an attack on the Utrecht in Leipzig tonight." The reply from Churchill, "It has to be Berlin." The attack was carried out on Berlin, but only 30 aeroplanes reached the capital. Only a few bombs were dropped on the municipal area and nobody was killed. 2 evenings later, Churchill again ordered an attack on Berlin. This time, Hitler went in person to Berlin. We know that because we know exactly what Hitler was doing at that time from his servants' diaries. I have the journals from Goering and from Field Marshal Milch. We have many private journals from prominent figures, the VIPs of the time. Hitler went immediately from Ober-Salzburg to Berlin to be with his people, because he now understood that the English had started to attack his capital. The Air Force wanted to strike back. Hitler said no, still no permission to attack London. Hitler sent for a lawyer, not in order to start legal proceedings against the English. He sent for the lawyer, Dr. Ludwig Weishauer, and told him, "You will fly to Stockholm immediately. Contact the British ambassador, Victor Mennet, and give him the details of the German peace offer. I read the file which holds the written proof that Churchill ordered Mennet to refuse access to the German lawyer." On the same day, Hitler asked Rudolf Hess, "Please get in touch with your English friends and tell your English friends or any voter that we are only looking for peace. And my offer for peace is the following." He would be prepared to withdraw the German troops from France, the Netherlands, Belgium, even Poland and Czechoslovakia. He wanted our agreement that he could have a free hand in the East and, of course, he wanted the former German areas back. This was the German peace offer. In addition, Hitler offered to put the German Wehrmacht at our disposal to protect the British Empire. A really generous offer, one might think. It is known that Hess was unable to establish contact with the English until May 1941. All this was at the end of August 1940. In the meantime, another 6 British air raids were made on Berlin. And on September the 4th, 1940, Adolf Hitler stood up in the Sportpalast in Berlin and made his famous, indeed notorious, speech. "These English, these madmen in England have now started to attack our cities. Berlin was attacked by British bombers 6 times within the last 10 days. If the English attack just one more city, then I will pay them back in their own coin. If they send 10 aircraft, I will send 100. If they drop 100 kilos, I will drop 100,000 kilos. If the English continue to attack German cities, then I will wipe out their cities." That is Adolf Hitler's famous speech. The same evening, Winston Churchill called the headquarters in England. "I want another attack on Berlin." So, you see, slowly, the responsibility comes to light. "Up till now, we have succeeded," says Churchill. And that comes from the speech records of the Russian files about Yalta, which I have. "Up till now, we have succeeded in killing 6 or 7 million Germans. And maybe we will be in a position to murder another million Germans by the end of the war." Interesting, isn't it? What Winston Churchill, who is accorded so much respect in England, said to his friend Joseph Stalin at that time. The Dresdner Altmarkt, always the symbol of the city's life, now becomes the symbol of its death.
Ich war ja dann auch am Altmarkt
und bin dort vorbeigegangen, wo die alle aufgestapelt lagen, die Leichen, die verbrannt werden sollten. Und wissen Sie, das ist alles, das hat man alles so gar nicht verkraftet.
After the bloody night of Dresden, they first tried to bury the bodies in the Heide Cemetery. But there was no end to the numbers, so they started to burn the bodies on the Altmarkt near the Frauenkirche. Brought together from every part of the town, the corpses piled up at this place of horror. Always 200 to 300 to a pile, a few tram lines in between to keep the bundles of misery together. The senselessness of the Allied blanket bombing of German towns becomes especially clear when you compare some statistics. The loss of production caused by bombs was about 9% in 1943. In 1944, it was approximately 17%. The iron and steel industry lost just 3.2% in the first half of 1943. And in the second half of that year and up to July 1944, only 6.9%. The highest production level during the whole war was achieved in August 1944 for munitions, in September 1944 for aircraft, and in December 1944 for U-boats. The Allies' official explanation for the bombing campaign against Germany was the so-called Casablanca Directive, namely the systematic destruction of the German economy and industry. From the comparison of statistics made above, it is clearly recognizable that this undertaking failed completely. The Casablanca Directive was not only an attempt to hide the real intentions from their own public, but also a measure taken to justify the bombing offensive. The organized mass murder of hundreds of thousands of innocent civilians in German towns was planned and executed. A multitude of irreplaceable cultural possessions fell victim to this act of barbarity. The Supreme Commander himself, Air Marshal Harris, eliminated any last doubts about the truth in his book, published in 1948. It must be emphatically stated that, with the exception of Essen, we never chose special industrial firms as a target. The destruction of industrial plant always seemed to us to be a kind of bonus. Our actual target was always the city center. Dresden, I have to say, ruined my life because this showed me that you cannot even trust your own government. When the government is responsible for recording its own history, you have to search further yourself. You have to find out for yourself. You have to not believe and go on searching. And this continuous searching is what helped me to find out the truth when I wrote my works and my history.
Sie werden also die Zahl von den 35.000 als Propaganda bezeichnen?
Ja, ist es auch. Ist es. Das ist es. Denn die Züge, die aus Pommern, aus Ostpreußen, aus Schlesien gekommen sind, die waren doch gerammelte voll mit Flüchtlingen. Und die 35.000, die würde ich nie anerkennen. Und es gibt ein Buch, da ist 350.000 angegeben. Aber es gibt auch Bücher, ich glaube, das hier ist auch eins, wo eben bloß 35.000 angegeben sind. Und unsere wollen das ja nicht wahrhaben. Die sehen das auch nicht ein, und aber die haben das ja eben alle nicht miterlebt. Gucken Sie mal, meine Schwester hat um die Ecke gewohnt von uns. Die ist am Lebenleib verbrannt mit ihrer Kleine. Und dann, ich will Ihnen mal hier ein Bild zeigen.
published numbers of the dead from all the attacks on Dresden range from 35,000 to 500,000, but the number of 202,040, mostly women and children, dead by March the 20th, 1945, can be vouched for. The fact is that the town was completely overcrowded with about 700,000 refugees at the time of the attack. The anti-aircraft defense precautions were insufficient, and the people were inexperienced in coping with air raids. There were 3,749 firebombs, high explosive bombs, and phosphor bombs dropped on the town. 750,358 homes were completely destroyed. In view of these facts, and given the reports of eyewitnesses, a number for the dead ranging from between 350,000 and 500,000 is absolutely realistic. The exact number of those died will remain forever unknown. How many died? Who knows the toll? In your wounds we read the scroll of the nameless ones in agony burned, in the hellfires raised by human hand. The tale of Dresden's fate since then is not to hand. For 45 years the town was torn from the fatherland. April the 17th, 1945, the ruins of Dresden were again attacked by 572 American bombers. In the official American history, this attack was not mentioned. In his book, Grand Alliance, Winston Churchill wrote, enchanted about his work, "I went to bed and slept the sleep of the saved and thankful."